Hello, friends. This is Dave Hurwitz, executive editor at ClassicsToday.com, here with, they just keep churning them out, don't they? Another Rachmaninoff Piano Concerto cycle, now featuring Yuja Wang and the Los Angeles Philharmonic under Gustavo Dudamel on Deutsche Grammophon. Now, this was something of a stunt. This was a Rachmaninoff Concerto cycle done in a very short period of time. It's in February of like 2020 something, 2023, I think it was. I can tell you what the actual dates were. And they did all of the concertos plus the Paganini Rhapsody all in a clump. It was a Rachmaninoff concerto clump. Let's see, here we have February 9 and February 11. And I think there were a couple other ones as well, 2023, celebrating Rachmaninoff's, you know, birthday, death day, something day, I don't know, some anniversary. Now, Yuja Wang has already done some serious Rachmaninoff, and not very well. First, she did the third piano concerto with this guy, Dudamel, with the Simon Bolivar Symphony Orchestra of Venezuela, with a very good Prokofiev second piano concerto with the coupling. But the Rachmaninoff third, so-so. Then she did the second piano concerto and the Paganini Rhapsody with Claudio Abbado, of all people, and the Mahler Chamber Orchestra. Oh my God, that performance was horrible. It was glacial, inexpressive, miserable. Everything about it was just like wrong. Yeah, so this had to be better. And it is. It's considerably better. She's a good pianist, a very good pianist, and she knows the music, heaven, for sure. For sure, but that still doesn't make it a great Rachmaninoff piano concerto cycle. Nope, not even close. It's not dreadful, but it has some issues. What are those issues? Well, first of all, let's talk about the Paganini Rhapsody, because that's Rachmaninoff's greatest piano work. It's a non-happening performance. And I'll tell you why. Well, first of all, the variations themselves, which is what the piece is, it's just a theme in variations, have issues with tempo, as in the 12th variation, the tempo di minuetto, which is no minuetto. It just dawdles along. It's stiff and unyielding. And then the 17th variation, leading into the famous 18th variation, that's the one where the piano has these triplets, the lower octaves, boom, 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 boom. And on top of that, the brass are going, yeah, da, da. That's the tune. That's the melody. Well, balances are all wrong. And that's a problem throughout these performances, by the way, which I'll talk about more in a second. But the thing is just too loud. And then the 18th variation, which it leads to the famous 18th variation with the big tune, there's something just not there. I'm not quite sure what it is. I'm not sure whether the rubato, the tempo flexibility, doesn't cut it. It's not natural feeling, where the climax somehow misfires. I mean, these are the kind of risks you run when you've got live performances, effectively one shot to do it, and you're releasing it no matter what. And I'm sure if people were sitting there watching that performance of the Paganini Rhapsody, they would have thought, okay, it's not bad, but it's not great. And at the very end, when the orchestra really has to come in with the Dies Irae, you know, with the Dies Irae, and it's supposed to, like, think of Fritz Reiner doing it. The color, the glitter, the hardness, the edge. There's nothing like that. It's just accompanying of no special character. And the orchestra matters in this work at all of Rachmaninoff's piano concertos, at least after the first. So let's talk about the concertos a little bit. Number two is a snooze. It's just boring. And one of the reasons it's boring is because of, as I mentioned in the Paganini Rhapsody, the balances. The piano is way too forward. One of the things about the second and third concerti is that they are essentially symphonies or symphonic works for piano and orchestra. And as often as not, the piano is accompanying the orchestra, not the other way around. But here, the balances are so skewed towards this jumbo piano that it becomes very, very fatiguing and monotonous. And you don't hear the melodic material the way you should. The opening of the second piano concerto, da 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 da. You know the tune, right? I mean, it's this huge outpouring in lower strings, and the piano's accompanying. It's just doing bum chung 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 chung, and it doesn't have body. It really doesn't have body. The climaxes aren't very powerful. You know, the first movement leading into the recapitulation, you really want to hear those, the orchestra come in with just the power of the string section. I mean, the best sounding thing here in the orchestra is the bassoon. It's a really beautiful bassoon play, especially at the beginning of the third concerto. And it's the same thing in the third. The third, you know, you've got the piano gets the opening tune, right? And then down the piano goes, doing lots of running accompaniment. You know, it's doing all this accompaniment stuff when the orchestra gets the tune. And you want to hear the orchestra, and you don't. Dudamel is really comparatively faceless. I know that Wang and Dudamel get along very well. They've worked together frequently, and obviously they've done the third piano concerto before. I mean, it's a better performance than they did before. The finale is particularly well done. It's quick and sprightly, and it doesn't have any dead spots. And it can. It's like in the slow movement, which has plenty of dead spots. I'm impressed by her facility, her technical aplomb, you know, the way that they keep the thing moving in the finale of the third. But getting to that point, it's just a slog. Now, the first and fourth concerti are the ones nobody cares about. I think the first is a charming piece. It's given a charming performance. And here the approach works a little better because it's so much more focused on the piano as a work. It's not a real symphonic interaction between piano and orchestra. And the fourth, well, I like the fourth because it's kind of hard-edged and a little bit less. It doesn't sort of disintegrate. It doesn't descend into schmaltziness the way two and three can. And again, this is a decent performance of the fourth, but the balances for me just about kill it. It doesn't sound natural at all. And that's a function of live recording in Disney Hall on the day in question with DG's engineers. I wish it were better. I wish that, I mean, this was something to really get excited about, but it's not. It's just an average night at the symphony. When you go, and I'm sure you would have had a good time, and I'm sure you would have heard a much more natural give and take between the piano and the orchestra than DG has recorded, you know, it's preserved on these recordings, and you'd have been happy with the result. But as it is, this is just not special. And we can do special with this music. We really can. So keep on listening, friends. Thanks for joining me. Take care.